alaikum. I'm Professor Dr. Hayder Mubarak. This is a practical presentation to practical aspects of the nose and paranasal air sinuses. The term external nose refers to the part that projecting from the face. Its structure is made of nasal bones and some nasal cartilage that are supported by the nasal septum. The nasal cavity, on the contrary of the external nose, the nasal cavity begins anteriorly at the anterior nares, or called anterior nostril, and ends posteriorly at the posterior nostril, or called coena. And the coena lies at the posterior, at the level of the posterior end of the nasal septum. Behind the coena, the posterior nostril, is the nasal part of the pharynx, which is called nasopharynx. The mucosa lining the nasal cavity in its upper third, and the mucosa lining the roof of the nasal cavity, is called olfactory mucosa because it is supplied by the olfactory nerve, that is the first cranial nerve. You know, here on the roof of the nose at the cribriform plate is an olfactory bulb followed by olfactory tract, and the olfactory nerves are passing through the cribriform plate to supply the roof of the olfactory mucosa and the upper third of the lateral wall of the olfactory mucosa, while the lower two-thirds of the nasal cavity is lined by respiratory mucosa. The nasal cavity is divided into right and left part by the nasal septum, and the nasal septum is mainly formed by the perpendicular plate of ethmoid, by the vomer bone, and by the septal cartilage. The walls of the nasal cavity, or boundaries of the nasal cavity, are the following. Starting with the roof of the nasal cavity, the roof of the nasal cavity is formed by the frontal bone containing frontal air sinus anteriorly, and then more posterior to the frontal bone, it is the cribriform plate of ethmoid bone forming the roof of the nasal cavity, and more posterior to the cribriform plate is the body of the sphenoid bone containing sphenoidal air sinus. These three bones, the frontal bone, the cribriform plate of ethmoid, and the body of sphenoid bone, form the upper boundary, or the roof, of the nasal cavity from anterior to posterior. The floor of the nasal cavity is the heart palate, which is the same structure forming the roof of the mouth. The heart palate forms the roof of the mouth and forms the floor of the nasal cavity. And you know that the heart palate is formed in its anterior two-thirds by the palatine process of maxilla, and in its posterior part by the horizontal plates of palatine bone. The medial wall is formed by the nasal septum, and we had just described the bones and cartilage forming the nasal septum, while the lateral wall forming the nasal cavity lateral wall of the nasal cavity is formed by the concha projecting from the lateral wall. We have three conchae from the lateral wall. The superior and middle concha are parts of the ethmoid bone, while the inferior concha is part of the, is an independent bone by itself. Actually, the lateral wall of the nasal cavity is not only formed by the concha. Anterior to the concha, there is a part of the lateral wall formed by the maxilla bone, and posterior to the concha, part of the lateral wall is formed by the vertical plate of palatine bone. You know, the posterior part of the heart plate is horizontal plate of palatine bone, and the vertical plate forming the lateral wall of the nasal bone. This vertical plate shows the sphenopalatine foramen that is connecting the nasal cavity with the pterygopalatine fossa. Concerning the anatomy of the lateral wall, we must add that the space, or the region above the superior concha, which is this one, is called the sphenoethmoidal recess. This is sphenoethmoidal recess contains the opening of the sphenoidal air sinus. In addition, The space below the superior concha is called superior meatus, and this space of the superior meatus containing the opening of the posterior ethmoidal air cells or air sinus. Similarly, the space below the inferior concha is called the inferior meatus, and it contains the nasolacrimal duct. Regarding the space below the middle concha, which is called middle meatus, in the middle meatus you can see an elevation which is called bulla ethmoidali, and below this elevation is a semilunar groove called hiatus semilunaris. The bulla ethmoidali containing the opening of the middle ethmoidal air cells, and actually this elevation, the bulla ethmoidali, is produced by the underlying middle ethmoidal air cells, which is also opened here in the bulla. The hiatus semilunaris also shows many openings. Posteriorly, the hiatus semilunaris shows the opening of the maxillary sinus, while anteriorly, the hiatus semilunaris shows the opening of the frontal air sinus and the anterior ethmoidal air sinus or air cells. To describe blood supply and nerve supply of the lateral wall and nasal cavity, we can divide the lateral wall and nasal cavity into four quadrants, and therefore we can say that the upper anterior quadrant is supplied by the anterior and posterior ethmoidal arteries, the upper and posterior quadrant is supplied by the sphenoethmoidal branch of maxillary artery. Of course, the anterior and posterior ethmoidal arteries are branches of the ethmoidal of the ophthalmic nerve in the orbit, while the sphenopalatine artery is a branch from the third part of the maxillary artery in the pterygopalatine fossa. The anterior and inferior quadrant is supplied by branches from the facial artery, which are lateral nasal branches or superior level branches, in addition to branches of the greater palatine artery, which is a branch of the maxillary artery from the third part of maxillary artery. The greater palatine is a branch from the third part of maxillary artery in the pterygopalatine fossa. It passes through the incisive foramen to supply the anterior inferior quadrant. And finally, the posterior inferior quadrant is supplied by the greater palatine artery also. The anterior inferior part of the nasal cavity is called the vestibule of the nasal cavity. This region shows massive anastomosis between the arteries supplying the nasal cavity, especially anastomosis on the medial wall of the vestibule, which is the lower anterior part of the nasal septum. This region, the lower anterior part of the nasal septum, which is the medial wall of the vestibule of the nasal cavity, is called the little area of Gesselbach, because it is a common site of chronic bleeding from the nose, which is called epistaxis. Also, you can see the lateral walls of the vestibule of the nasal cavity, which is producing by the ala of the nose. Of course, the medial wall is the nasal septum, which is the little area. The lateral wall of the vestibule, which is the ala of the nose, containing many coarse hair, which is called vibrissae hair. Regarding the nerve supply of the nasal cavity and lateral wall of the nasal cavity, also we can describe the nerve supply into four quadrants. The upper and anterior quadrant is supplied by the anterior ethmoidal nerve. The upper and posterior ethmoidal, the upper and posterior quadrant is supplied by the lateral nasal nerves, and the lower posterior branches are or quadrant is supplied by the palatine nerves, and the lower and anterior is supplied by the anterior superior alveolar branch of maxillary nerve. Now we will describe something about paranasal air sinuses. This is the frontal air sinus, and this is the sphenoidal air sinus. The frontal air sinus lies within the plates or tablets of frontal bone. It is not usually present in children. It occurs at the age of 7 years. And the sphenoidal air sinus lies in the body of a sphenoid bone. Actually, the sphenoidal air sinus is related laterally to the pituitary gland in the cella torsica and to the optic chiasma here and the chiasmatic sulcus, and also to the internal carotid artery when it is running medial to the anterior glenoid process. In addition to the frontal air sinus and the sphenoidal air sinus, you can see here that the superior and inferior concha are removed in this sample of skull. And we said that the superior and middle concha are parts of the ethmoid bone. And when this superior and middle concha is removed, now you can see the ethmoidal air cells or air sinuses, which are anterior, middle, and posterior. Of course, the concha sometimes are called turbinate bones. So here, this sample showing removal of the superior turbinate bone or superior concha and middle turbinate bone, which is the middle concha, to see the ethmoidal air cells, because these two concha are part of the ethmoid bone, and when you remove them, you will see the sinuses and the ethmoid bone. Finally, the sphenoidal air sinus, it is located inside the body of maxilla and is the largest sinus in the body. The maxillary sinus is a pyramidal in shape with its apex laterally near the zygomatic bone, and its base medially near the nasal cavity. Actually, its base forms the lateral wall of the nasal cavity. Its roof superiorly forms the floor of the orbit, and its floor inferiorly formed by the alveolar process carrying the teeth of maxilla. Inflammation of all the sinuses is called sinusitis, and it is very important condition. This is an CT scan image for the sinuses. This is the maxillary sinus. This is the maxillary sinuses, right and left maxillary sinuses. This is the nasal cavity. You can see that the maxillary sinus is pyramidal. Its apex is near maxilla, while its base forms the lateral wall of the nose. And this is the ethmoidal air cells. You can see here that the ethmoidal air cells are to the inside of the superior and middle concha. Even in this sample, the medial wall of the orbit had been removed. This part of medial wall is formed by the ethmoid bone. And when you remove the medial wall of the orbit, which is formed by ethmoid, also you can see the ethmoidal air cells, which are anterior, middle, and posterior ethmoidal air cells or sinuses. There are many points in the theory regarding clinical aspects of the nasal cavity and nose. One of them is epistaxis. You can examine the nasal cavity using a speculum to see the site of epistaxis and treating it by cautery or else. Another clinical point is that sometimes in trauma to the skull, you may result in a fracture at the base of the skull and a fracture of cribriform plate. Because above the cribriform plate is the middle cranial fossa, you may have infection introduced from the nose to the middle cranial fossa, resulting in inflammation of the meninges of the anterior cranial fossa, resulting in inflammation of the meninges and thus meningitis of the meninges in the anterior cranial fossa. Also, the cribriform plate, as we said before a while, is covered by the olfactory bulb, and so fracture to the olfactory bulb as a result of damage to the olfactory bulb as a result of fracture to the cribriform plate will result in a loss of a smell sensation, which is called anosmia. Rhinitis, or common cold, is a viral inflammation of the mucosa of the nose, and this infection may pass to the anterior cranial fossa via the cribriform plate. Also, the infection of the mucosa of the nose in rhinitis may pass to the nasopharynx, and from the nasopharynx it passed to the eustachian tube, and then from the eustachian tube to the middle ear, and thus the middle ear will be infected in a company or in association with the rhinitis. Or the rhinitis, inflammation of mucosa of the nose, may pass through the opening of paranasal air sinuses, which had just been described in the meatuses, and thus resulting in sinusitis as a complication of rhinitis. Also, infection of the nasal mucosa may pass through the nasolacrimal duct to the conjunctiva and lacrimal apparatus. That's all about practical aspects of the nasal cavity and nose. Thank you.